Mr. Murphy, good morning, buddy. So. Okay, so I'm gonna talk to you about the, best hot plasma composition analyzer data processing that we do on board. So I'm gonna start by providing a little bit of background on MMS and HPCA. A little bit about what the HPCA hardware produces, and look at how the process is split between the hardware and software components, and talk about that in some detail. Talk a little bit about what our output data products are, and give a glimpse of our operational results. So MMS is a mission to look at the magnetosphere, and it's a set of satellites. And you can see here, they're in stack here as they're being prepared for launch. With all understanding magnetic reconnection, it's going to look into the magnetosphere varying different scales. So these four satellites are flying a tetrahedron, and they're going to be at very large scale, or relatively large scale, like 150 kilometers down below 10 kilometers. So by changing that size, we'll be able to look at the changes over time in the magnetosphere, and particularly the boundaries associated with reconnection over varying time scales, so we get those different measurements. We are both the day and the night side, so it's a mission with about 6 months for each of those observations and a fair amount of time at the beginning of commissioning and then transition between the two different observing regimes. Observatories is fairly complex and pretty large with 26 instruments, so we're going to be looking at a lot of different things. This is a look at the instrument deck, and so you can see quite a lot of instruments arrayed here. Several instruments have multiple setups. So for example, FBI has an instrument to look at electrons and an instrument to look at ions. They're arranged around the outside, so they have a full sky view between the set of them. So the indications are HPPA, which is a 3D ion distribution, and we look specifically for the four ions that are listed there, so hydrogen, helium, helium plus and oxygen, because we're all really interesting components. Field sweep looks at the electric and magnetic fields. The plasma investigation, or FBI, is looking at electron and ion intensity. And again, they have this full sky view and a fairly large range of energy that they look at. These are the energetic particle detectors, and that's another all-sky ion electron energetic particle view at a different energy range. There's a kind of an interesting element here. We have the active spacecraft potential controller, which attempts to keep our electrical potential consistent so that our readings are easily calibrated. So we have, you know, an active component. It's not all just instrumentation. And the central instrument data processor, because of its complexity, ended up identified as an investigation as well. Although it doesn't really collect any data, it does set the data processor for one of the instruments that are part of ETD. MMS has a fairly low orbit, and for our purpose here, called the region of interest. This is where the reconnection events can occur. So here is where we're collecting data. And so we've broken up the orbit into two pieces. We have a slow day region where we collect some data, but we don't expect to have high interest data because there's no possibility of reconnection here. And then the fast survey period where we're collecting higher resolution data from all of the instruments. In addition, some portions of windows of this region of interest will include what we call burst data. And there's going to be a process on the ground where we look at the results from the survey data. high resolution data, but we cannot bring all of it down. There's just not enough bandwidth to do that. So it is reported during the region of interest, and then it's that data, the post area data, our downlink is analyzed, and before we come to our next long contact, set of data is determined from burst to downlink, and that will be included. So all the FAT is on survey data only, but the burst thing we only bring down. This is HPA, so a fairly typical configuration for this kind of an instrument. So there's kind of a diagrammatic view. This is what it actually looks like. So you can see the color where the particles come in, the electrostatic analyzer, and we'll see a little bit more detail in a second, the time flight analyzer and detector, and then our electronics box is all mounted together in one unit. Back to our top level view, we can see HPCA over here. So we have one HPCA on the on each observatory. We have a full sky view and a half spin. So you know, we have multiple instruments with a mass spec, tuned for the four key ions I mentioned before. It turns out we also collect some background information, and depending on how we configure it, it's possible that we can get oxygen double plus as well. So we are redundant, and clearly some of these other instruments are somewhat redundant, although the loss of an instrument affects their ability to see information. For HPCA, we can get by only three observatories, so we're effectively redundant by having a fourth observatory. We can do our sampling investigations without actually having all four, but right now everything's great. Things are working fine. So how the instrument works, if you're familiar with these kinds of instruments, this may be all news for you. So we'll come in here, and then the electrostatic analyzer sets only specific particles. If particles are too fast or they're too heavy, the electric fields here will determine whether or not they'll be detected or rejected. And so they either exit or collide upon the walls here of the energy analyzer. The particles do get through, they get a foil here, which then splits off into two columns, so we can measure a start time and an end time, so we can get our time of flight. From the flight, we can determine how heavy the particle is. Is it hydrogen? Is it oxygen? Whatever. And so we see that there is a detector down here, the anode, and we can see our start position and our stop position. We can tell where we are in our rotation, and we can tell by this distance what our time of flight is. There's something that is unique about HPCA, however. One of the problems with these detectors is that it will tend to flood the detector. So the RF component that's part of this electrostatic analyzer, and that RF component reduces the density of the hydrogen so that we can see the other particles in greater resolution so we don't just become saturated. So that's something that's unique, and that is something that's working very well for us in practice. This is our data handling board for HPCA. Well, here is our connection to the detector here, the time of flight subsystem, output to the central instrument data processor. So that's where we report our telemetry and receive our commands. And then we have our power supply connections as well. Very important because we're going to control the power in fairly precise detail. So these are our external interfaces. There's an FA that mitigates or manages all of that activity for us, controls the interfaces. And so we work, and it has a fairly substantial role in the processing that I'm going to talk about. We have our gate, and that's where we do the software processing part of it. We're using RTEM. This is the memory where we accumulate the partial results. So water, done, and I'm going to describe this in more detail, it switches and is accumulating into the other one. In the meantime, this first one is made available to the client software so we can read it and process that data. And then we have our working memories, our RAM, and our images and even square phones and so on. EDA data collection cycle moves through 64 energies. That energy analyzer is able to determine different characteristics and different energies. So we can see the different particles at these various different energies. So that's a 64-step cycle. Within that cycle, we see that we have to change our power supply, and that power supply has a settling period. So each one of these brief windows of about 10 milliseconds, we have a settling period and then a data acquisition period. Then they're accumulated until we have 64, which is a full range, and this line here represents the fact that we change that energy over time over that, what we call an azimuth, to collect a complete set of data at the different energies. They're added to get put together so that we have 16 of those within a half spin, and then that half spin, because of our rotation, gives us a full 5 years. Some of these steps are slightly different in size, so if you look at the 0.65, you hold that up, if you use the 9.77, but some of the energy, some of the changes to the power supplies takes more time, and we can't do it in such a short period, so there are a small number of steps that are a bit longer, and it comes out in 0.65 in total. The hardware produces a couple of main things. First of all, we get time-of-flight histogram data. So that's a core. The second thing that we get is the what they call logical data. So we know when the starts occur, and we know when the stops occur, and we know those counts. And so between this combination of information, we can understand what's going on with the different kinds of particles. In this direct event gives us some raw data that we can look at, but in practice, we don't need to do that except for checkout, that sort of thing. There's some extra information here. It's your signature that this data is going down, and we can tell if it's not. And then we have some housekeeping data internal to the flight unit that will also be available to us. It comes from the FPGA for the time of flight. It's broken into three pieces. So you notice before I talked about survey data and burst data. We have to record both of those at the same time. So we actually get two different streams. It's fast here, but it would be either slow or fast survey. So the survey data and then the burst data. In addition, there's a raw stream that we can also receive. There are some limits on what we can do with that, but effectively we have three streams from the hardware. So in addition, you see that here we have our polar angles, so there are 16 of those. Those were the radial positions around the detector, and then the time of pins are separated into 512. So two dimensions of data are represented here. And these two dimensions of data are coming at us every 10 milliseconds. So every time we get a sample of data for a particular energy, we get this block of data. In addition, the FPGA produces those raw time of flight histograms, ion distribution for us. Again, it's by polar angles, but now it has decoded those individual bins within the time of flight histogram to produce individual counts for each one of the ions of interest, so hydrogen, helium, and so on. So it's doing emulation. So our division of labor is the FPGA does the add of the co-adding in we done in single energy. And the software is going to do everything that occurs at a higher level because we can produce so much data, we have to do a lot of data reduction before we can send it down to print. One of the interesting things we have to do is the sensitivity of the instrument is such that at these different energies, there's actually a shift at a certain point where the position at the time of flight for a particular ion moves with respect to that energy. So every single energy step, we have a customized position here that we program in the FPGA, and then that's accounted for when those sums are produced that you saw on the previous chart. These are unique to each detector, so even though there's an attempt to make the detector similar, they don't come out exactly the same, and they have to be somewhat customized. There's a long process of calibration that was done in the lab to account for whatever small variations came out in the manufacturing of those units. In terms of data decimation or co-adding, you can see we have a lot of reductions that we do. They're all powers of two. So what we have here, if you look at the line, we have the bins at polar angles. These data reductions are done by PGA. They can be done in a single time step. The entity, now we have 60 flows that occur over a single azimuth. Each one of those has 64 sets of data from the time flight data. And so we do that estimation in the flight square. In addition, then we can accumulate those same energies across azimuth and we have the software as well. With the ion cover, we've already taken apart the bins and summed them appropriately, so we don't have that anymore. Here we only have three different dimensions that we have to worry about. Right here, then, in black, it's done by the FPGA, in red, it's done by the software. You'll see our raw data, so we have some restrictions on that. We have a way to bring it down, and there are certain conditions where we use it, but because the data volume can be very, very large, we want to do special things with it, and use just one to one. Our data processing is essentially a pipeline, so this is now a simplified view, more focused on the software than the hardware. We have our FPGA, our same phone registers I mentioned before, data coming in to our decimation process. So some decimation may be done here in flight and in flight bins and polar angles. Coming over here, then we're starting to do additional decimation and energy and azimuth. We also do log decompression, so we do logarithmic compression of the data to reduce it by a factor of two, and then we lossless compression with writes over here, packetize it into CSVs, and send it back out. Looking at it in more detail, you will see that we have a time of flight up that gets the data from the PGA. That data has two parts. There's the data we've been talking about, which is decimated or may be decimated, but we also have some uncompressible data, such as time information, some error information. So we don't let that go through this process. We wouldn't want it to be lost through the loss of compression, and there's little enough that there's no benefit to include it in the losses portion of it. So we do pipeline, time of flight, lossy compression, lossless compression, packetizing, and finally writing out. So all of these are gone. There are various times with double buffers here, double buffers here. Later we end up with full strings of buffers, particularly when we're packetizing here, so that we apply to where these processes only have space available to do the next step in their process. Now here we've got our uncompressible data. This time to packetize and produce the end result that's at into the final document or telemetry, and then it's finally ready to go and be sent out. Looking at this in a little bit closer detail for the timing aspect of things, you can see up here we have individual entries, 0 through 60. Those are combined together for an azimuth every 625 milliseconds. Once one is complete, then we need to start things at a high level. So we have our lossy compression, and we see the budget on time here. We have our lossless compression, we see the budget on time here. And then finally here, we're ready to write it out. You can see how that it builds up until finally we're in a continuous process out here for our pipeline. Looking at the data production in a little bit more detail, we have an A side and B side. survey and our MERS data. The same thing is repeated here for the young people. Others are treated in a special way. There aren't as many options here. So we combined in different ways. So for example, you may be able to see the line here, the raw data here and here, and some of these natural common buffer. We don't know what the number of operations to be done. We just don't have time to do that. So you have to choose. You can have one raw data product. It could be time of flight. It could be ions. It could be one of these other data products. But we have to consume. We only have a limited amount of memory. We have to pick which one we want at any given time. However, the burst data, the time of flight histograms, and the ions are so important, we retain those down here at the second level. So we have a burst buffer and a survey buffer. And for each one of the ions in this, the time of flight. And pass down as we go through our different processes, so we finally get to our loss of compression and our packagizing down here. Again, I've got something kind of set over here on the side. One of the things that I mentioned earlier was that we do have quality measures. That quality measure is considered the trigger data, and so we produce a trigger message from some of this raw data up here. The process is treated separately as a small data product. It doesn't need to go through the complex process that's going on here. We do have support for subsampling, so we can choose one of them. I mentioned the logarithmic compression. We take it from 32 to 16 bits. So we put two there. Our write compression gives us at least a factor of two, maybe as much as a factor of three. The data is very agreeable for write, so it works very well. Another view of our data products. So here on the top, this is our survey data product, and this is our data product. And so in this view, you can kind of see the way we do our data decimation. So here, we have very high resolution data, time of flight. Up here, it's somewhat reduced. We can see some more angles. So up here, we have a little bit higher resolution, and there's a little bit lower resolution down here, this particular example. But we're accumulating all the energy in just one big set. So this is a whole view, but we have resolution in the individual bin. Similarly, so this is the energy is completely aggregated together, and the atoms are completely aggregated together. That's why it would be a whole side view, so a half spin of data. Similarly, we see the resolutions here for data, but down here we have higher resolution. But these are not necessarily the final configuration, but they are representative of the kind of things that we're doing in terms of the data production. Finally, we have to package the data up. The approach we're taking is to essentially produce single data products for fast survey data, slow survey data, and burst data. So they all have the same form, but they have three application IDs. So
I just off the screen.
Okay. So we've got, because these science data products all look the same, there are some flags that say what data is going to be present. Do we have ion data? Do we have unflight data? Do we have model data? So this serves to say what's there. We add the headers for whatever we need, so maybe a time of flight header and an ion header, and then we append the individual science data packet. So this is necessary because we might have time of flight data completing every other energy or every other atom. We might have ion data every atom, and we might have watchable data every 16. So we would have some data products that we have only one, or some messages that we have one data product. client data and this information is relatively minor and is not, in terms of volume, and is not compressed. I mentioned before that we have launched. We have completed our commissioning process. We're in phase one operation, and we're starting to get results. Up here, this is the hydrogen, helium, oxygen for HPPA. And this little window here, notice these discontinuities in the data. This is not necessarily a reconnection event, but it is an event of interest that may, in fact, be related to reconnection. So we're getting good. We're seeing the kind of results that we were hoping to see. Everything is working well, and we're in production. That, I'll take questions.
Any questions? Okay, thank you very much.